as we talk about, we started talking about disinvestment last class. So we'll talk about things further then. We'll talk about reasons for disinvestment. So what we will talk about is that what will be the logic that a firm disinvests or a government disinvests in a firm. I'm sure recalling from last class, we can keep in mind that all disinvestment is not privatization. So it's only when you disinvest beyond 50% of the total share of the firm and shift the management to the private sector that we call it privatization. All right. And disinvestment is when government sells its shares to any other enterprise. I mean, government doesn't need to sell it to a private firm or an individual. If it sells to any other enterprise, we call it disinvestment. Now, when we look at reasons for disinvestment, I'll quickly first cover it with you and then I'll give you a write-up. So see, first thing is that when government has to exit the non-core areas, see, when we talk governance, we qualify it as core areas and non-core areas. So core areas are those where you cannot do without a government. Things like, say, administration, law and order, judiciary, even education, healthcare, water supply. I'm talking Indian context. In US, you can do without a government in education and water supply and all, but not in India. So these are sectors which are core. Core areas, you need your government to be present. But then there are certain areas which are non-core, non-strategic, like running a hotel business, running an airline, running say a ball bearing business and water pump manufacturing business. All these places you don't need the government. So these are non-core areas. So in that case, what the government can choose is that it can withdraw itself from the non-core area to focus better on the core area. You know, that is one reason why one suggests that we can do with some disinvestment, even if privatization needed, in the non-core areas. All right. The second aspect of disinvestment is when the government has to signal to the market what they plan to do in future. Like suppose I have my future plans as a government to exit a particular industry. Like say for a second, that in 1955-60, it was 50-55, it was important that aviation is taken over by the government. Over the period today, we realize that it's not important that you need an Air India in the system. So then this signal to the market should have been coming for last 10-15 years. And we should have exited gradually. I'll tell you why. I'll get you into Air India talk a little bit. But first of all, understand it like this. Air India's share has been continuously declining in aviation passenger carriage. And it is now 12.5%. Even last year, it was 14%. So if you don't take an action immediately, it may be possible that the share goes below 10% and then it becomes kind of a junk. Because the lower the share, lesser will be the value that the market will put on it. So it's important not only to take the action, it's important to take the action at the right time. That's very relevant. When you take action at the right time, then you get better rewards as compared to when you keep delaying it. With Air India, it's a prime example that we have been delaying it for some particular reasons, but we have been doing that. This is not something that the government needs to do today. Again, I repeat, 50 years back, 60 years back, things were different. So when I was teaching you, say, policies and second five-year plan and all, one kept insisting that this was required. Similarly, today what is required is that these areas is where government can skip away from, not needed. Non-core areas, loss-making regions, not something which is where the government is required. So government can signal to the market that, look, this is the future disposition. You all can take your position, and over the period, you can see us exiting this sector. You know, so that is another thing. Third thing that we need, or that can happen, is when you talk again about disinvestment, the proceeds from disinvestment, money proceeds, I mean, can be used for other activities. You know, imagine when we say that we don't have money to build rural roads, and we don't have money for rural schooling, primary schools in India, primary healthcare centers in India, putting medicines in these places. We say we don't have money for stopping hunger deaths and all. So if we don't have money for all that, then we should not have money for firms which are not needed to be run by the government, but are run by the government and running continuously in losses and are perpetual burden on the exchequer. You know, that is the idea, that, you know, money has to be understood in that term always. If we have money to do, because, you know, ultimately it's the same money that you're using one place or the other. Like when we put 2,11,000 crore for recapitalizing the public sector banks, then this 2,11,000 crore has to be accompanied by reforms in the banks also. If the reforms don't happen, then you will have another situation 5-7 years later. Then again, you will have a loss that will be contemplated. So I know we are an unequal economy, and we are a feudalistic economy. So we still build statues, and we still, you know, focus on grandeurs, and we somewhere lose the track that there are too many people poor, too many people illiterate. They have to be helped up. We take them for granted, you know. To be honest, we take them for granted. We believe they are there, and they ought to be there. That's completely fine. If they are there, not a problem. It doesn't take away our sleep. The day it starts taking away our sleep, you know, imagine when you say, oh, India is ranking 77 in ease of doing business. And you can feel happy about it. I can feel happy about it. 65 ranks growth in the last 4 years is also a good idea. And I'm not taking it away. We can feel happy about that. But we can feel happy about it only when on the ground investments rise because of it. You cannot feel happy about it because an index is marking you high. I mean, it's like feeling happy that you came first in your college only to realize there is no job for you. I mean, what's the point getting happy then? I come last in my college, but if I get a nice job for myself, I'm happier then. You know, so life is always a long run thing. So you need to understand it in that context. You know, rankings and all can keep happening one way or the other. But again, I repeat, what can make us happy is what happens on the ground. Or what should make us happy. What should make us happy is not what doesn't happen on the ground. You know, and then shoddy say points that come across. I know this is an election year, so things will be irrational. That's understandable. You know, that is why in Air India also, when we brought it for disinvestment, what do? We say that we are disinvesting Air India, but the company which will buy Air India will have to take over 33,000 crore of its loans, and government will still keep 24% in Air India, even after selling. So government will sell only 76% stake. And government will keep the right to nominate two people on board of directors. Who will buy it then? The real elephant in the story is government ownership of Air India. Till you don't get rid of that completely, if people have to bring 2 lakh crore, 1.5 lakh crore worth of investment in a company, then they will bring that investment only if they believe that investment is secure, and they will be free to use it as they like, and they will be able to make profits over a period. Otherwise, aviation is a tough industry anyways, you know? And then especially with rising oil prices and all. So given aviation is a tough industry, and you make it tougher by making these rules. Why? I mean, imagine, government takes the loans, 52,000 crore in Air India, and asks the private party buying Air India to take 3/4 of that loan. I mean, who will take that deal? Think about it from a business perspective, nobody takes such deals, you know? So even if you say Air India was brought on the chop block, but nobody came for it. Well, nobody came for it because it was a bad deal. And you know, the best part about our government currently is that they have selected people in institutional places who are somewhere around their mouthpieces. You know, so throughout the procedure when Air India was put for sale, 2 months, they kept saying we are getting a lot of offers and there are too many companies approaching us and it's a matter of time we will sell it. And when the day came when people had to apply, nobody turned away. If they were getting a lot of offers, and if too many companies were approaching them, at least 2 could have come to apply. You see, nobody coming to apply, but throughout they kept publicizing this, that we are getting a lot of offers. You know, so, and this was not said by government civil aviation secretary and all. This all was said by DPAM chairman, Department of Investment and Public Asset Management. This was said by, say, Niti Aayog deputy chairman. That is why I said that institutional positions now have people who are mouthpieces. You know, and it's not only now, it has always been the case, more or less. In fact, when people say that institutions are being compromised and all, it brings a smile to my face. Because in UPA 1 and UPA 2, we had something called a National Advisory Council. and it could overrule even cabinet decisions. And none of them were responsible to the people. I mean, there were none of them, except Sonia Gandhiji, who was a member there. Nobody else was an elected member. So you know, our politics is a politics of hypocrisy. That's not one understands it. You know, that today when there is a current government and you have to dislodge it, so you keep counting on how institutions are being, you know, mismanaged and all. When RBI fights with government, it becomes headlines. It has always been headlines. Subbarao fought with Chidambaram. And RBI and government fights are normal. Obviously, RBI, and then people say autonomy to RBI. It's like saying autonomy to Vibhas by teaching in Vajiram. I mean, it's so ridiculous. I'm working for an institution. End of the day. So my autonomy will be limited autonomy. I cannot get unlimited autonomy. Nowhere in the world do they get it. The governor will be finally appointed by the government. The institution runs in the name of the government. You know, so if it is running in the name of the government, then it is just an institutional mechanism. So far, so good. Let's not expect RBI to be a Lokpal. You know, it's not independent of the government. So you have to understand it in that context. Because these days, when I see these articles and they are flooding the newspapers like anything, makes my life easy. Because when you read 4 or 5 newspapers and they have 15 articles talking the same thing, then you know that okay, you have to read only 4 or 5 and you don't have to read others. Because in any case, half of them look just. When you read them. But when you look at it, these are needless controversies that we have, because they are not controversies at all. We are just creating it. It's like, when I said Vibhas is autonomous in Vajiram or not. Well, if you come to me and tell me how does Vajiram teach, you bring a conflict of interest in my mind. It's a moot point. I mean, what will be my assessment of Vajiram? Because I am seeing Vajiram from a point of view where I'll find it good. I'm finding it, seeing it from a teacher's point of view, not from a rival's point of view, and not from a student's point of view. So my point of view will be different. You know. So similarly, when you say RBI and government, well, RBI is appointed by the government. RBI has been created by the government. Capitalization has been done by the government. It's the government's arm to run the monetary policy. And again, I repeat, everywhere in the world it goes like that. I need to see one instance when the RBI governor went against the government and said it publicly that we are not doing what you want us to do. Nobody does that. You can't do it, because end of the day, it's a government institution. Even only in economic models, it is called exogenous. You know, otherwise exogeneity is limited. So when you look at it, these are the things where you need to understand that it is a government's call. You know, finally, imagine tomorrow when inflation will rise, as common people, not as economic students, but as common people, we will be blaming the government, not the RBI. When inflation rises, nobody says RBI, because of RBI inflation has risen, and therefore we will still vote for this government. Could we say that? So there is no problem. Sarkar ki koi galti nahi. Inflation is 15%. That's okay. RBI is responsible. Sack the governor, but the government is good. What will we say? What is the government doing? How come inflation is rising? So you know, if you say what is the government doing, then the institution which will take the responsibility and accountability is the institution which will have authority. You know, so in that context, I was telling you, and this is where one needs to understand. Like tomorrow, if judicial system is not doing good, we blame the judiciary. We don't blame the executive. We don't say it's because of the government the judicial system runs bad. We say it's because of the judiciary. You know, Supreme Court has to do something about it, and so on. You know, we don't say Ministry of Law and Justice has to do something about it. You understand this? So this is how accountabilities have to be fixed. Similarly, when you are talking about a public sector unit, let's not act that the public sector units are independent of the government. They're dependent on the government. If LIC was not a government company, they wouldn't have taken over IDBI. Nobody takes over a junk spending their own money. IDBI is a junk. 25% of their assets are non-performing assets. Who buys such company? But LIC is a government company. So they get an instruction from the Ministry of Finance, buy this IDBI, 51% stake. They do an amendment in the parliament, in the LIC Act, because otherwise LIC Act doesn't permit you to buy more than 15% in any company. So they do an amendment in LIC Act and then ask LIC to buy it. So be it. Similarly, ONGC taking over HPCL, you know, due to which ONGC is now running in red. Like it's gone into losses, in spite of being a Maharatna. But they took over HPCL with 37,000 crore rupees. Again, ideally, I don't think ONGC kind of a company would have taken over HPCL. But again, ONGC is government, HPCL is government, government comes along, says buy it. As a managing director, what will you say? No, I will not buy it. Right, we transfer you. Don't buy it, the next one will. I mean, so much for the autonomy and so much for independence. Maharatnas are supposed to be autonomous, you know. But this is what I'm trying to teach you for last 1.5 odd classes, that when it is government in the room, it's government in the room. Government, that is why it brings a smile again to my face when I hear people saying that in communication we should not privatize MTNL or BSNL, because during emergency government will be dependent on private sector. Government, dependent. Sarkar is the word we use for it in Hindi. Sarkar means almighty. You know, Huzoor, my Baba. You know, so in that case, saying government will be in trouble, government will get up one day and nationalize all the companies. You go fight the case in the court. No, we have nationalized you. That's what government can do. Government gets up one day and says, demonetized 86% of your currency. Chill out now. You know? So that's government. So it's very strange when people get up and say, government, what will it do? Well, government can do anything in a country. Government can kill. And government can kill and people will rather clap. Because the government will show that you were an anti-national, hence you were killed. Government can do that. You know, so let's not underestimate government. Government has huge power, especially in a country where in any case justice takes a backseat. So you know, these dramas I wanted you to leave first of all, because you know sometimes newspapers act as if we are in France or in US, where government has checks and balances, and you can be a Trump and you can still be stopped to some extent. You know, we are India, or we are a system where government does rule the roost. So in that case, with disinvestment and all, the objectives have to be very clear. So as I told you, one objective can be to make sure that we exit the non-core areas to focus on the core areas. Another objective can be to give a signal to the market that we don't want to be in this market anymore, so you can take your positions. Another objective can be to use the proceeds of the disinvestment and use them for better expenditure, like maybe infrastructure development, rural soft infrastructure like education, healthcare development. That is where you need government more as compared to maybe running a motor pump company, you know. And other than that, what you need to disinvest in all those firms which are loss making and which are non-strategic. Please, okay, think of it. Many people say, let's not judge public sector on the basis of profit. That's very true. So let's judge public sector on the basis of equity creation. And let's judge public sector on the basis of balanced regional growth. And let's judge public sector on the basis of job creation. And let's judge public sector on the basis of better utilization of resource. And if on all these bases public sector is not performing well, then why do we live with it? You understand this? I mean, in India, we are lovely people. We don't ask these questions. We keep putting more and more money into our public sector. Rather, the people who are paying taxes are sometimes found saying, yes, yes, let's put money in public sector. So get rid of that ideological hangover. You know, that is the important aspect of it. These are ideological hangovers. Ideologically, somebody told us that public sector will be for the benefit of the people. Right? But we have to objectively assess if they are for the benefit of the people. And if they are not, we'll get rid of them. You understand this? That is the idea. Also understand one thing. When I'm teaching you this, because since there's a difference between one class and the other, never think that I'm saying, or anybody says, that you should privatize all public sector. That's not the solution either. That is why you have a system of memorandum of understanding, so that public sector can get some autonomy and work. You have a system of Maharatna, Navratna and Miniratnas, so that again you can give them autonomy and they can work. And you have a system where Department of Investment and Public Asset Management does a case-by-case study. Case-by-case study means take an individual public sector, study them, check what is the best solution that can go for them, and then take the approach there. Because that is what you suggest. When you talk about whether we should go for privatization, disinvestment and all, there is one more benefit of disinvestment, I'm not saying privatization. That benefit is, if you disinvest, you disinvest via the market. So you register the public sector in the stock market. When you register the public sector in the stock market, you go by the norms of SEBI, you know, Securities Exchange Board of India, which will mean audited reports of public sector units will have to be now submitted to Ministry of Corporate Affairs and to SEBI, and this should be external audit, which will mean all details about who got the contract, what was the basis, what expenditure was done on a particular project will all be in public domain. That brings transparency. Otherwise, with opaqueness, today we don't even know why a contract is given, and what is the value of that contract, and what is the basis, and who is benefited, and so on. So that brings nepotism into picture. So if we want to get rid of this nepotistic culture, one way is to make them transparent, and the way to make them transparent is list them in the stock market, which will force them to submit audited reports. You know, so if somebody takes a wrong decision, they will know that it is more chances of getting caught now as compared to what it was earlier. So these are the reasons to disinvest, sometimes privatize the public sector units. I'm giving you a write-up now, and then we'll take it from here thereafter. You write. First, the government can exit non-core areas which are not strategically important for public sector ownership in order to concentrate on core activities of governance then you write next second point Government should provide a signal to the market about future industrial structure and its method of disinvestment, like whether it is or whether you are doing minority sale, strategic minority sale, that will decide it. So its method of disinvestment can be used for that. Then you write next. The proceeds from disinvestment can be used to develop other assets which can be more useful in inclusive growth and then you write fourth listing of public sector on stock exchange will make it compulsory to submit audited reports with external auditing which will result in better corporate governance. Corporate governance is decision taken by the board of directors for benefit of shareholders. All right? That is corporate governance. So the decision taken by board of directors should be for betterment of all shareholders, not only few. And that is what can happen if you list it across. Then you write precautions during disinvestment or privatization, any of the two. Precautions to be taken during disinvestment or privatization. Another way of looking at it is, if these precautions are not taken, then that can create the losses from disinvestment. Alright, then what can be the problems of disinvestment? So if the precautions that we are talking about are not taken, then the problems of disinvestment can be observed. Alright, so losses that we think of from disinvestment. First is, you write that proper valuation of the firm should be done. Proper valuation of the firm should be done before privatizing it. See, earlier the rule was that we will privatize it on the basis of a book value. Book value means what the account books suggest. But sometimes what happened was public sector got things for free like land or spectrum and there was no book value for it. But then that doesn't mean that when you privatize it and give it to private sector, you again give it for free. Like for example, we sold VSNL, Videsh Sanchar Nigam Limited, to Tata's, which became Tata Teleservices later on in 1997. And we sold it for 1,547 crore rupees. But later on, when valuation was done, it was realized that spectrum that we gave, I can believe we understand spectrum, the airwaves which help us in the communicating, right? And firms are sold that. So the spectrum we gave Tata's with VSNL was itself worth 2,000 crore. And the land that Tata's got with VSNL was 1,200 crore. So what should have been sold for around 5,000 crore was sold for 1,547 crore. Now the only people happy in it will be Tata's, because they got something for free. But this is public resource given to a private company without charging any money from them. And when the government did the inquiry, people said it is because it is in book value, and the book value did not show any value for spectrum and land, so we sold it at 1,547 crore. But then, again I repeat, this spectrum can be given for free to a public sector, or land can be given for free to a public sector, because they were initiated to serve the people. But if you are privatizing this public sector, then there should be money recovered for all the assets that public sector has. So proper valuing is important. Now we have learned our lessons. So after 2006, we have made a rule that any privatization will go through only after the proper value has been calculated by an investment banker. So we will hire an investment banking firm, they will do the valuation entirely, and that will become the base price. And on that base price, then the auctions can happen. Or sale can happen. Alright, so that is what we do now. So this is suggestion one. Since we don't do it in every case, we do it, but we do it selectively. Then second point you write, social security of workers should not be compromised. Social security of workers should not be compromised. So that's another thing. See, as we disinvest or privatize, then it's possible that the private firm may not be willing to keep as many workers as what the public sector is willing to keep for the business. So again, in that case, there are 2-3 things to keep in mind. First of all, because you know, again, when as soon as we bring public sector for sale or something, rhetorics start happening in our country. We become rhetorical. Or 10,000, let's say Air India. Then I read an article which was saying 10,000 jobs are at stake. I mean, 10,000 people work for Air India, so then we are assuming everybody will be fired. It's not valid. Even if it is privatized, the private company will not fire everyone. So the first thing is to understand that when you privatize, it doesn't mean that everybody will be fired. You know, so who will be fired? Maybe if we take 1/3 of the people are fired for a second. So then take care of the vulnerable group. Vulnerable group are people who are in their last 10, 12 years of job. You know, that is one, because if somebody is say 45 plus, 50 plus, into the last 10 years, then it's very difficult for this person now to, if the person is removed, to find a new work for themselves, and that will bring problems. So that is one. Another vulnerable group will be people who may have been appointed on a special category, say physically disabled and all. That again is a vulnerable group, you need to protect it. And another vulnerable group are set of people who can be replaced by machines. So replaced by machines like, say, your clerks, clerical cadre people, sweepers, cleaners, and all, tier 3, tier 4 workers. These are your real vulnerable group. Because please understand, in a public sector undertaking, or any undertaking for that matter, you also have a group which doesn't work, you know, and just uses its position in the company to perpetuate that not working attitude. You can't be lenient to them. In our confusion, we do that. This is one thing I'm just sharing with you and passing it on to you. In our country, this culture has to change, where the one who creates nuisance is left alone. The one who creates nuisance should be caught by the scruff of the neck and thrown out. You know, and not only in company, sometimes even in family. You know, but you will see that. Okay, in case you don't understand my point entirely, somebody is drunk, the drunk person misbehaves, somebody else is sober, the sober person objects and says, how are you misbehaving? Everybody will gather and tell the sober person, doesn't matter, he is drunk. He is drunk, beat the fellow up. Because he is drunk and misbehaving. So you can't be giving lineage to him that he is drunk and misbehaving. You know, you have to give lineage to the one who is not drunk and hence not misbehaving. So getting drunk is your priority. You can do that. Misbehaving is not. But imagine we have created a culture. And I remember the jokes from college days, not jokes, practical jokes actually, from college days, where what people would do, even those who were teetotaler, they would just sprinkle some, alcoholic drink on their body, you know, show as if they are drunk, and then do all sorts of things to people whom they did not like, in the disguise of being drunk. The next morning they would come and say, oh, I'm so sorry, I was drunk last night. I'm not sure whether your hostel behaved well or not, but mine did not at all, you know. So when I was a student, and in my hostel days, I've seen several such instances. Things planned. Okay, you get drunk, because when somebody told a person, I remember once, I was a Hindu in those days, somebody told a person that then you drink in any case, so why don't you get drunk and do it? He said, fool, you don't understand, if I get drunk, then I cannot do what I want to do. Well, I'm drunk, so I won't know what I'm doing. This fellow doesn't drink, so sprinkle some alcohol on this fellow, and send this fellow, he will do, because he will not be drunk actually. Now imagine, this is taking advantage of a social system which gives excuse for you to be, for being drunk. And you can very well come next day and say sorry without actually being sorry about it. You know? Because if you were sorry, you will not drink again. So, you know, this system and this culture prevails in industries also. Those who misbehave, those who don't work, even the supervisors believe, okay, let's not touch them. They are difficult nuts. Leave them alone. We should rather focus on those workers who work with. And let's, you know, make them work even for those who are not working. Look at our government, what does it do? Those who don't pay taxes, they are not tracked. Those who pay taxes are asked to pay more. This culture has to change. Yes. The monthly magazine copy is Hindu. I have been saying this to Ravindran sir too many times. It copies Hindu and unfortunately parrots Hindu. If it can do a little better research, it can write better. And since you mentioned this to me today, because I don't read that magazine, I read it once or twice and then I realized that contents have to be improved. I'm going to meet Ravindra sir today again, so I'll carry it on to him. Because remember, this is where, apart from privatizing Air India, you don't have a way out to revive this company, because the company has been in perpetual decline for 21 years now. You know, you don't have a way out. We have tried everything. That is why it is pretty uninformed. I mean, good you told me, because I think we can maintain that standard at Vajiram at least. You know, that 21 years we have been running into losses. And we have been trying to put money into it. We have changed the management. We merged Air India and Indian Airlines. We have done everything. We have seen it running into losses for one big reason. Because there are, for two reasons rather. One, huge political interference, where government misuses the company for its own travel and all, and doesn't pay it on time and all, which it cannot do if it is privatized. And second, because the employees feel their job is permanent. This is one big problem, again, cultural in Indian horizon. Please understand this. That is what I was going to come to now, apart from that. So, you know, if you ask me, just to answer your question in completion, that we have tried it all already. When you say one more chance, there have been too many one more chances given to them. You know, 1997 we gave them, 2002 we gave them, 2005 we gave them, 7. And since 2012, every year we are infusing 2,500 crores. So believing that Air India should be revived, and the largest question is, why should we revive it? I mean, airline is a capital intensive industry, so it doesn't create jobs. And Air India is a flying company, so it doesn't serve poors. Poors don't fly in India, at least as yet. you know. And with respect to remote area flying, you don't need Air India, because with Civil Aviation Policy 2016, every airline has been asked to fly 3% of its seats to remote areas. So now, no, it is not that remote area flying will remain an issue. You know, their market share is continuously declining. So they are not even the national carriers supposedly today. IndiGo carries 40%. They carry only 12.5%. So they are a bleeding point to the exchequer. So larger question is, why should we, you should revive something if it is worth reviving. So if somebody says revive ONGC, I can understand. But revive ONGC, it's worth reviving. It's a strategic sector, oil refinery or gas refinery. But reviving Air India, why would one talk about reviving Air India? Tomorrow then somebody should talk about reviving Kingfisher also. I mean, I'm serious. Because if you say workers' job is at stake, then workers were in Kingfisher too. And creditors have their money stuck up in Kingfisher a lot of it. So let's revive Kingfisher somehow. You can't, see, this is where you beat the basic idea of business. You cannot revive what is becoming junk. So get rid of it, and thank you for informing me on this on a very right day. Because after today's classes, I have to see sir in any case. Because I have been insisting on this pretty often. Unfortunately, my time doesn't permit me, otherwise I could have contributed a little bit to the books that they write. But when you look at it, generally, have an objective view of what the decision is. That is what I was coming to. Imagine we are one of the few countries of the world where you have a permanent job in a temporary life. So whether you will be alive tomorrow or not, you are not sure. But we are sure that the job will be there 35 years. Look at the permanency culture we have created. Tomorrow, if Ravindran Sir tells me that, Dr. Jha, I love you a lot, and therefore, no problems, you go to the classroom, you do whatever, we have kept you permanently. I will come start singing. With my kind of voice, 99% people will leave. You know, ideally 100%, 1% is only for statistical error. So in that case, you know, but then and somebody gets up and says, sir, we are here for economics, and I tell you, no, arre, ek aur suno. So remember, when you make it permanent, you make your workers badly complacent. You know, then they are sometimes willing not to work. Recall your college clerks. You know, it's a universal pedigree they have all over India. You know, that they will not be found on time, or they will be shirking work. So if you go to them in the morning, they will say come after lunch. If you go to them after lunch, they will say come in the morning. You know, one way or the other. Sometimes they will say this paper is missing, this person is not there today, shifting you from one table to another. Ye kaam yahan nahi hota, wahan hota hai, udhar chale jao. This is about shirking work, not showing the willingness to do it. So, you know, that culture will go as you put some pressure on people. See, remove the word permanent by a word called secured. You know, jobs are secured if I'm working efficiently, and jobs are secured if there is a temporary hassle. Temporary hassles all of us can face. You know, it is possible. But if I can work efficiently to make sure that the job remains secure. You know, so efficiency cannot be compromised for that purpose. We are running a public sector company, corporation, so it's not a charity house. You have to give that message to your people. That it's not a charity house you are coming to, where you come, don't work, but we will still give you salary. And we will give you pension also when you retire. That creates the hassle. You know, the market gets distorted by that. So you will have to push people. And I repeat again, it's not that nobody works. The problem is then some don't work. And those who work are also doing the work of those who don't work. So in that case, some people take a lot of pressure and others don't take any. That's iniquitous in any case. Because I'm never saying that nobody works in the public sector. There are several who are working pretty hard. You know, and therefore, they're taking the job of the others who are not working, and that becomes the problem. Because everybody gets promoted on the same time with the same discretion. But that doesn't help efficiency at all. So that is the point again, that you need to make sure that, so how do you secure your workers now? The vulnerable group and other groups. Yes, yes. Yeah, so right kind of work culture guided by one system that is called profitability. Remember when Delhi Metro increased its fare last year, so much of hullabaloo was created. Kejriwal ji was so upset. Yeah, there he was. Then the government, central government sent him a letter saying that 15,000 crore is the loss we will have if we don't increase the fare. So if Delhi government takes 50% of it, then central government will take 50% of it, and we will not increase the fare. He did not speak on that after that. You understand this? So it's about, see, not only Delhi Metro. Look at the work culture you see in SBI. Look at the work culture you see in Steel Authority of India Limited. You know, these are all Bharat Heavy Electricals Limited. These are all companies running on good work culture. So it is not necessary that